knocking me out. Got my head spinning. No kidding, I can't pin you down. What's going on in that beautiful mind? I'm on your magical mystery ride, and I'm so dizzy, don't know what hit me, but I'll be alright. My head's underwater, but I'm breathing fine.
Right now, so come and sing with us.
I could sing of your love forever. I could sing of your love.
Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Good afternoon, everyone. That was a good icebreaker. I'd just like to say, even though I've planned something to say, I couldn't plan for what I just saw. Can I hear an amen? No. Can I hear an amen?
Amen.
If you believe that the most beautiful couple standing in the building is right here, put your hands together. Don't stop clapping now.
That's all right. That's all right. That's all right. That's all right. Even though I'm here to welcome you guys, I just can't stop looking at these guys. Because at the end of the day, it's all about these guys. Amen? But without further ado, I'm here to welcome you guys. Thank you for coming. You know, for friends and for family, I know you made the journey. But the truth of the matter is, there's people that traveled around London and England, but there's those who even traveled the world, Christina. That, you know, is that right? Who got on the plane to come here? Put your hand up proudly. Don't be shy now. Come on now. Anyone else? Round of applause for that now, everyone. Come on now. I don't plan to break down what's going to take place through the day, but just be blessed and know that despite the broken homes around our world today, one young man and one young lady has gone against the grain. And if you believe that, give them one more round of applause. At this time, we're going to ask everyone to bow their heads as we open up with a word of prayer. Father God in heaven, it's almost impossible not to be excited today. Through this act of love, we have seen not just people, but young people make this step. And the truth is, in a world like this, Lord, that's very rare. But Lord, I pray right now that this day can be pleasing in your sight. We ask that you can send down your holy angels, your Holy Spirit, to dwell among us. Bless us, Lord Jesus, as we go through this day, celebrating this momentous step of Michael and Christina. We pray these things in no other name but the name of Jesus. And everyone said, amen. Amen. Please be seated. Thank you.
And so we know to rely on the love God has for us.
God is love. Whoever lives in God lives in Him.
I really love you.
Yes, I do.
I really love you.
I really love you.
Because you first love me.
I really love you.
I really love you.
Yes, I do.
I really love you.
I really love you.
afternoon, everyone. Yeah. Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. All right, I'm sure that everyone here who knows Christina Harper Fuller would like to take this opportunity to say that she has never looked as beautiful as she does today. Men, don't clap too loudly. Michael is watching. Don't clap too loudly now. You are truly the essence of female loveliness. Gorgeous is a big word, but it has nothing on you today. And Michael, it is very evident that much effort has been made on your part. Very evident. You did a good job. You did a good job. I don't know. Your groomsmen look pretty well. I thought it was just one of them forgot their socks, but all of them did. I like that. I like that. It is an honor to be here with you both, to be a part of this glorious day, to be surrounded by your family and your friends, those who care deeply for you both. I consider it a true privilege, Christina and Michael, to be asked to speak on this grand occasion. I don't think anything new will be said today, but my hope is that as a result of this message and as a result of this union, we will all leave with a sense of deeper and loving relationships. The message is primarily for Michael and Christina, but the message also, being the word of God, rings true for every relationship in this building. Before I begin to pray, I'm going to ask if everybody can at least put their phones on silent. Not for me, don't do it for me, do it for the bride and groom. Just out of respect, I was thinking about it. Don't turn it off. You want to take pictures. We're in that age now. Just pull it on silent so that the service won't go on undisturbed. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for Michael. And we thank you for Christina. We ask even now, Spirit of the living God, that you'll continue to fall afresh on them. As your word is lifted up, I pray even now that you will do what needs to be done. As we hear your still small voice, these things you ask in the name of Jesus. Amen. For those of us who were born from the 1980s to the year 2000, are called Generation Y or the Millennial Kids. We are the last generation that played out in the streets. Games like Run Out, games like Kiss Chase. And this is the thing, we wasn't playing Kiss Chase to kiss nobody. When somebody was chasing us, we was truly trying to run. We would play Knock Down Ginger. We were the first to play video games and the last to record songs off the radio on cassettes or watch movies on VHS. We rolled, now I didn't roll, I couldn't have this thing, but we rolled with Walkmans and felt proud to own one. We played Atari, we played Super Nintendo and Sega, and we thought at a stage that the internet and the millennium bug was the end of the world. We are the generation of Thundercats, come on somebody, Super Ted, Power Rangers, Ninja Turtles, He-Man, Saved by the Bell. We are also the generation of the Fresh Prince of Bel-Air. This amazed me. This is why God is so good. But we traveled in cars without seatbelts or airbags. We lived without mobile phones. We didn't have 99 plus TV channels. We didn't have surround sound. We didn't have iPhones, Facebook, or Twitter. But nevertheless, we had a good time. We had a good time. Within this period, we saw the rise of one of the most pop family shows on TV. It's aired for 8 seasons in the US on NBC from September 20th, 1984 until April 30th, 1992. It was the number one show in America for 5 consecutive years. The TV program created the main cast as a household name. It is none other. Do not steal my thunder. The Cosby Show. Well done, well done, well done. The Cosby Show was centered primarily on the Huxtable family. Dr. Heathcliff Huxtable, who is also known as Cliff, his wife Claire, and their 4 children, Denise, Theo, Vanessa, Rudy, and you just cannot forget the later addition of the granddaughter, Olivia. They were the model family. They laughed, they communicated, they shared feelings, they danced, they mimed their songs down the stairs. They were able to express themselves in a real way. Whether they did wrong or bad, they can always speak to daddy or mummy. Dr. Cliff, who was a medical doctor, had his office in the basement of the house, so he was always nearly available for his family as a father. Claire, who was a lawyer, always seemed to be around when the children needed her most. The family was far from perfect, which is why we could relate to them so much. But what was clear is that they were a family centered on the marital union of Cliff and Claire. It was a sore source of strength for the children. The marriage of Cliff and Claire showed us, the viewers, what it meant to have a happy home, a happy marriage, not only to fall in love, sit to me now, but how to grow and stay in love. Throughout the series, the love flame burned in that house. However, the reality is this, that the Cosby Show was just a show. It was not real. Evidence shows that a large majority of us who grew up within the 1980s through to the year 2000 came from dysfunctional homes. As a matter of fact, what I have learned in my own experience, no home is perfect. And even though we had TV programs such as The Cosby Show, many of our families were somewhat different in showing and expressing love. It has been shown that the reason why, now get this, the reason why many of us today, regardless of your age, struggle with the concept of not so much falling in love, but staying in love, is because we have not seen too many examples. We have too many examples on TV and the movies and music when it comes to falling in love. Everybody knows how to fall in love. Boy meets girl, oh, I'm in love. But the question now is this. Are we seeing that same love growing from strength to strength 5 years down the line, 10 years down the line, 20 years down the line? Our main training, our influence, our key values of life have been formed at home primarily through our childhood and teenage years. Many of us grew up with different distorted versions of love within our homes. To highlight a few, there are those that witnessed parents who were happily married and who knew how to love and stay in love despite the issues at home. There are many of us who witnessed parents who never got married. Some of us grew up in a single-parent home and saw a predominant one-sided love. Or we were exposed to domestic violence situations or experienced emotional abuse. Some of us, we didn't grow up with any parents. It was grandma or our guardians or a foster home. Where some of us had parents who acted one way at home But when they left the house, acted another way. We can be a mixture of these or different types of versions of these. But as adults, as we grow up as children, Generation Y, the millennial kids, we are then expected to leave home and find that special partner and create a happy, loving home. Something like the Cosby Show, even though we have not seen this love modeled in our own lives. Research shows that if we didn't see love in action, forgiveness at home, mercy at home, words of affirmation, laughter, love, encouragement, security, boundaries, support, or acceptance at home, then by definition, our view of love will be slightly distorted. And if we grew up in a Christian household, not seeing a lasting love, then your view of God will also be slightly distorted. One of the greatest needs in our homes today is simply to see love lived. Don't want to hear it no more. Everyone can sing it, say it, preach it. But it's our children. They only recognize our character, our lives. That's what talks the loudest. So today, as we sound the songs, where's the program? Give me the program real quick. Because these songs are not familiar to me. I will sing of your love forever. And the other one was, help me. My prayer for you both, my prayer for everyone here, is that we will come to sing those words as a lifestyle. Herein lies the problem. We all bring to our relationships our different versions of ideals of love based on our own upbringing and understanding. But despite these various views of experiences of love, I want you to know that whether you've had a great experience or a negative experience or both or a mixture of both, little becomes much when it's placed in the hands of the master. The truest and best example of love you will ever see and experience is the love of Jesus. The love of Jesus, the song says, is so wonderful. So high, you can't get over it. So wide, you can't get around it. So deep, you can't get under it. Oh, wonderful love. We were just singing it today. And we were singing that thing like we believed it. Psalms 127 verse 1 says, "Except the Lord build the house, they labor in vain that build it. Except the Lord keep the city, the watchman waketh but in vain." A hair braid looks like two strands, but the mystery is there is a first strand that keeps the two together. And like in a Christian marriage, it is God that keeps husband and wife together. Amen. I want to give you 3 points real quick on how to help you not just continue to fall in love, Michael, but to stay in love, Christina. My hope for them, my prayer for them, my prayer for my own marriage, my prayer for your relationships is as you grow together as a couple, Michael and Christina, that 10 years down the line, you can look back and say, wow, I thought I loved you 10 years ago, but I'm realizing that was a baby love. My love now is so deep, so powerful. Because I'm not just saying it with my mouth, I'm experiencing that thing. Matthew 22 says, "Master, which is the greatest commandment in the law?" Jesus said unto him, "Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. This is the first and greatest commandment." Point number one. Pastor Daly, give me a wave. Pastor Daly, I know you've been sitting with Pastor Daly. Today I could have spoken about communication, how to deal with conflict, the 5 love languages, the 7 this, the 7 steps to perfect marriage. But I've realized that the foundation to all of this, the foundation is found in the Bible, the first and greatest commandment, love God. Love God, love God, love God. Listen to me, love God. The true blueprint of love is God. As you grow in relationship with God, as you fall deeper with him, in love with him, listen to me, we think that if I put my focus on the woman, if I put my focus on the man, then everything will work out okay. And I will tell you this, I've tried this thousands of times. But what I am learning, if I put my focus on God, He will give me a power to do what I could not do. For it is God which worketh in you both to will and to do of His good pleasure. Christina, when Michael plays the fool, which he will, when Michael does not put his weight, which he will, when Christina, Michael, acts crazy, which she will, when Christina refuses to understand, which she will, when you both don't see eye to eye, because of your personal commitment to trust in the Lord with all your heart, leaning not unto your own understanding, but in all your ways, acknowledging Him so He can direct your paths. When she is playing up, you will be able to love her. Why? Because it's God's love. When she is messing about, you can have wisdom because it's God's wisdom. When you're not seeing eye to eye, you will have peace because you have God's peace. This is God's order. Too many of us are too reactive. Man, leave the dishes unclean. Man, leave the dishes on the kitchen. What kind of foolishness is this? You good and worthless, good for nothing, man. We're quick to slam people down and shut them down and this and that. But the reality is this. Love is not a feeling. It's a decision. I decide to love my wife, not because she did something good, but because love demands it. Matthew 6:33 says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. He in turn will give you the power, Michael. Listen to me. He will transform your mind, Christina, give you a new perspective, and do for you what you cannot do for yourself. Psalms 34 says, oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man or woman that trusteth in Him. Point number two is simply to love on each other. In our scripture reading, the first and greatest commandment is, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and the second is to love thy neighbor as thyself. We must be careful not to put the cart before the horse. The Bible says, love God first, and loving others will come naturally. Let the horse run free, and the cart will naturally follow. The Greek word for love is not like the word for the English love. Some of us use the word love loosely. I love Arsenal football team, even though I don't go to support them for real. I love Haagen-Dazs ice cream. I love this, I love that. But when the Bible uses the word love, this is what the Bible is saying. It's not just a noun or I'm in love. Oh, that's it. No, love means I am in love with you and I aim to keep on loving you. No questions asked. In other words, when the kitchen is not done, I will step up and do it because I love you. When you make a mistake, I will go the extra mile and do this thing because I love you. And the problem we have with the word love is because too many of us are selfish. This is why. As men, Michael, as men, we feel that if woman number one doesn't do it right, I will find woman number two. There's no issues with this. And the reason why we feel this way, go jumping and jumping and jumping, is really saying we have low security issues. Because we can't deal with our business at home, I have to run somewhere else. Because I can't work at home and fight for my marriage, I have to say, I want a divorce. I want to do this. What happened to you? You're not who you used to be. Finding excuses. Male and females. Agape love can't help but love. When you understand the love of Jesus, as your singers were saying, He loves us even when we're not lovable. He loves us and we don't even deserve it. And for me to love like that must be by the grace of God. This is why He says, love me first, and I will give you a love that you have not tasted or experienced before. Love is patient. Hello, somebody. Love is kind. Love does not envy. Too many red-eyed people in this place. Before you're looking at the bride and the groom, you're looking at everybody else. What car are they driving? Look at them shoes. What shoes is that? What phone is that? What dress is that? How can she do her hair like that? Red eye. The minute I saw a clock with no socks, red eye. Why didn't I think of that? It does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. Hallelujah, somebody. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with truth. It's always protect. Michael, your job is to protect your wife. Protecting in the biblical term is simply to love her. To always trust Christina. Always hope. Always perseveres. And number three is love is a commitment. Folks, love is a commitment. It's not a feeling. I used to think when I stopped feeling that feeling, that was it. It's time for me to move on. And I realized that I kept on doing that until I understood the concept of love. I love even when I don't even feel like loving. See, some of us, we go to work even when you don't want to get out of bed. Some of us, we do chores even though we don't want to. Do you know why? Because you know if you don't work, you ain't getting paid. So even when you don't want to get out of bed, you will still get up and you'll be on time too. Because there's a principle behind it. Love is that driving force. A wife came into the office of her pastor full of hatred towards her husband. Uh-oh. I do not only want to get rid of him, I want to get even. Before I divorce him, I want to hurt him as much as he's hurt me. I feel like our relationship just can't work anymore. The pastor suggested an ingenious plan. Go home and act as if you really love your husband. Tell him how much he means to you. Praise him for every decent trait. Go out of your way to be as kind, considerate, and generous as possible. Spare no efforts to please him, to enjoy him. Make him believe you really love him. After you've convinced him of your undying love and that you cannot live without him, then drop the bomb. Tell him that we're getting a divorce. That will really burn him. With revenge in her eyes, she smiled. Beautiful, beautiful. Will he ever be surprised? And she did it with enthusiasm, acting as if for 2 months she showed love, kindness, listening, giving, reinforcing, sharing. When she didn't come back to the office, the pastor called, are you ready now to go through with the divorce? Divorce, she exclaimed. Never. I discovered I really do love him. In closing, each of us comes to this relationship. Right now, Michael and Christina, you both come to this relationship with unique strengths, vulnerabilities, and histories. As individuals, you are beautiful people all by yourselves. Yet, when the two of you are blended together, you form something even more beautiful. Those strengths can blossom, those vulnerabilities can be cared for, and those people can soar. I wish you both, Michael and Christina, God's continual blessings for now and forevermore. Amen.
Thank you.
To you, love has kept you, and love will continue to keep you. So just three things: cherish your love, protect your love, nurture your love. When I come home, we're going to eat some food again, not at the place that we had it the last time, somewhere a bit more shranky. We're going to eat some food, we're going to laugh, and we're going to celebrate together. Enjoy this day, be blessed in this day, dance in this day, love in this day. God bless you. Love you both.
Christina and Michael, I've traveled a long way to be here with you today. Auntie Marilyn and I, we have been involved in probably about 600 weddings, but this is one of the happiest we have seen. Can you say amen?
Amen.
This is one of the happiest we have seen. Yeah, I see the tears, boy. Go ahead.
We want this time to participate with Christina and Michael in what is called a hand ceremony. So we invite you now at this time to hold your hands up in front of each other. All I ask you to do is to watch each other's hands. Pull them back a little bit, because I want you to watch the hands. Just watch the hands. Concentrate on the hands. These are the hands of your best friend, young and strong and full of love for you, that are holding yours on your wedding day as you promise to love each other today, tomorrow, and forever. These are the hands that will work alongside yours as together you build your future. These are the hands that will passionately love you and cherish you through the years, and with the slightest touch will comfort you like no other. These are the hands that will hold you when fear or grief fills your mind. These are the hands that will countless times wipe the tears from your eyes, tears of sorrow and tears of joy. These are the hands that will tenderly hold your children. These are the hands that will help you to hold your family as one. These are the hands that will give you strength when you need it. And lastly, these are the hands, Christina and Michael, that even when wrinkled and aged, will still be reaching for yours, still giving you the same unspoken tenderness with just a touch. Press your hands together now. Dear Father, bless the hands that you see before you this day. May they always be held by one another. Give them the strength to hold on during the storms of stress and the darkness of disillusion. Keep them tender and gentle as they nurture each other in their love. Help these hands to continue building a relationship founded in you, rich in caring, and devoted to reaching for your perfection. May Michael and Christina see their four hands as healer, protector, shelter, and guide. We ask this in the name of Jesus. Therefore, if anyone can show just cause why Christina and Michael may not be lawfully joined together, let them now speak or hereafter forever hold your peace. I guess nobody's saying anything. She wants to make sure she sees every bit of him. I require and charge you both, as you shall answer in the day of judgment, when the secrets of all hearts shall be disclosed, that if any of you know any cause or impediment, while you may not be lawfully joined together in matrimony, ye do now confess it, for be ye well assured that if anyone coupled together otherwise than as God's law doth allow, are not joined together by God, neither is their marriage lawful. I want you looking her in the eye, Michael, as you say, I do solemnly declare.
I do solemnly declare.
He'll get it together. Don't worry. He's just a little nervous. Mike.
I do solemnly declare
that I know not of any lawful impediment
why I
Michael Neville Winston Caradise not be joined together in matrimony.
May not be joined together in matrimony.
To Christina Gail Rianne Harper Fuller.
To Christina Gail Rianne Harper Fuller.
Christina, I do solemnly declare
I do solemnly declare
that I know not
That I know not.
Of any lawful impediment.
Of any lawful impediment.
Why I. Christina Gail Rianne Harper Fuller.
Christina Gail Rianne Harper Fuller.
May not be joined together in matrimony.
May not be joined together in matrimony.
By Michael. Neville Winston Caradice.
Winston Caradice.
To Michael. Wilt thou have this woman to be thy wedded wife?
Not yet.
Just let me finish, all right? Hey, I came from New York to read everything that's here, okay? Will thou have this woman to be thy wedded wife, to live together after God's ordinance in the holy estate of matrimony? Will thou love her, comfort her, honor her, cherish her, in sickness and in health, and forsaking all other women, keep Christina only unto yourself as long as you both shall live? Can you so declare by saying a loud, I will?
I will.
Christina. Wilt thou have this man to be thy wedded husband, to live together after God's ordinance in the holy estate of matrimony? Will you love him and honor him? Look him in the eye, cherish him in sickness and in health, and forsaking all other men, keep thee only unto him as long as you both shall live. Can you also answer in the affirmative by saying, I will?
I will.
Can the church say amen?
Amen.
Who giveth this woman to be married to this man?
Her mother, and I do.
Amen. Amen.
He didn't knock everything down.
Michael, now I ask you to repeat after me. I call upon these persons here present.
I call upon these persons here present.
To witness that I. Michael Neville Winston Caradice.
Michael Neville Winston Caradice.
Do take thee. Christina Gail Rianne Harper.
Christina Gail Rianne Harper Fuller.
To be my lawful wedded wife. To have and to hold.
From this day forward. For better.
For worse.
For richer.
For poorer.
In sickness.
And in health.
To love.
And to cherish.
Till death do us part.
According to God's holy ordinance.
And thereto.
I pledge thee.
My love.
Christina. I call upon these persons here present.
To witness that I.
Christina Gail Rianne Harper Fuller. Do take thee. Michael Neville Winston Caradice. To be my lawful wedded husband. To have and to hold. From this day forward. For better. Take your time.
For better or for worse.
For richer or for poorer. In sickness and in health. To love and to cherish.
To love and to cherish.
Till death do us part.
Till death do us part.
According to God's holy ordinance.
According to God's holy ordinance.
And thereto.
And thereto.
I pledge thee, Michael.
I pledge thee, Michael.
All of my love.
All of my love.
Can the church say amen?
Amen.
What God has joined together, let no man put asunder. For as much as Christina Gale, Rianne Harper Fuller, and Michael Neville Winston Caradice have consented together in holy wedlock, and have witnessed the same before God and this company, and thereto have given and pledged their love to each other, and have declared the same by the joining of hands, we pronounce that they be husband and wife together. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you of his peace. The God of peace himself sanctify you wholly. The Lord mercifully with his favor look upon you with all spiritual benedictions and grace. Ye may live together unto him in this life. In the world to come, share his everlasting life. Let the church say amen.
It's 20 below.
I give you this ring as a token of my love and appreciation for all you've done for me.
Yes.
And with this ring, I do wed you.
I give you this ring as a token of my love and my never-ending love and affection for you. With this ring, I thee wed.
Pray with us. Father, we are always in awe at the way you move and what you do. I want to first thank you for blessing my nephew Michael with Christina, and for blessing Christina with Michael. God, we stand here, like Anthony has said, casualties of broken relationships. But we know that, God, you must be the center. And today we dedicate this marriage to you, believing that you have taken the reins even through courtship. And Lord, please, whenever they try to take it back from you, you grab hold of it with your power of the Holy Spirit and guide them safely to eternity. Father, we dedicate this marriage to you. For this is not just a wedding, but a marriage. It is not just, hallelujah, a contract, but a covenant. And so today, Lord, this covenant, we ask you to seal it with the blood of Jesus Christ. We pray, Lord, that this will not just be an event, but a lifestyle. We pray this just won't be the Cosby Show, like Anthony said, but this will be character building for eternity. We pray, Lord, that you will divorce the devil from this situation in Jesus' name. And whatever plans he has laid for them throughout the years, I pray that you will break his plans and cast him out in Jesus' name. We also ask, Lord, that any negative curses, generational or others, will cease to function from this moment on, and only the power of the Holy Ghost will have his way in this relationship. We pray, Lord, hallelujah, for a wonderful family of children and grandchildren and great-grandchildren, if you don't come before. But most of all, we dedicate and consecrate these lives, because Lord, this is not about here, but it's about eternity. Seal their love with your love, in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit. Let all the witnesses say amen, amen.
We're moving ahead. We're here to declare to you the past is over in you. Things are made new. Surrendered our lives to Christ. We're moving, moving forward. Oh, 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 oh. We're moving forward. Yeah, forward. Say you made, you made, I wanted to.
Special for you and me, oh yeah, special for you.
announcement. There's a black Honda blocking the way. Registration WN06GMG. That's a black Honda, WN06GMG. And also a blue Mercedes. Can everyone hear me? A blue Mercedes, registration YT04YHK. Okay? Black Honda and a blue Mercedes. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everybody. Good afternoon, everyone. Can I just make a few announcements, please? Thank you very much. I've just spoken to the bride and groom. They'll be coming out shortly, but just a few announcements for your attention. Please to remind you that there are two receptions after this program. There is the first one, the sit-down meal at 4 o'clock, and the second one is the evening celebration at 6:30, which will now start at 7 o'clock. So if you had the invite for 6:30, that reception will start at 7 o'clock. Please note that the evening program at 7 o'clock is open to everybody. The bride and groom would love if we all could be there, but the 4 o'clock service is invitation only. If you are not sure, because I know some of you is gonna say, I don't have my invite, I don't remember if it was 4 or 6:30, please see Auntie Van. Just give them a wave. Please see Auntie Van. The reason why this is important, because if you turn up at the 4 o'clock reception and your name is not on the list, there may be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Folks, some of us are gonna be like, you know what, let me just try a thing, let me try and push this thing. There's gonna be bouncers at the door. Please, if you know, if you're not on the 4 o'clock reception, please, the bride and groom are asking, please make every effort to be there for six. Just testing, I was just testing you guys. Also, while we are leaving, so after before the bride leaves, if we could pick up some bubble mixture, which are outside in the foyer, so that as they're leaving the main entrance, the majority of us can blow some bubbles as they're leaving, and light refreshments will be served by the kitchen area. So once again, there's two receptions, 4 o'clock and 7 o'clock. The 7 o'clock reception is open for everybody. The 4 o'clock reception is invite only. Thank you very much.
party.
One, two, one, two. Ladies and gentlemen, this time I want to present to you the newest couple in England. Mr. and Mrs. Paradise. Put your hands up. To present the marriage certificate to the new wife. So, I present you this. And now, at this time, ladies and gentlemen, we are going to ask the new husband to salute his new wife in the best possible way.
Hey, hey!
He knows. Going to allow him to do whatever he wants. Thank you.
Hallelujah.